Today, the story of the 12 Hours of Sebring, 1990. Hello, everyone, and welcome to the IMSA Grand Prix Hour. I'm Bill Stevens, and today we look back at the 38th running of the 12 Hours of Sebring in Sebring, Florida, and specifically, the Battle of the GT Prototypes, or GTPs. Jaguar had finished 1-2 at the opener at Daytona, and the Nissans had come back to finish 1-2 at Miami. We'll also take a look at the sights and sounds of an IMSA race weekend besides the racing. A look at Sebring 25 years ago. We'll see how high-tech conditioning prepares endurance drivers of today. And a special feature on how the danger of fire is minimized by race teams competing in the IMSA series. And this was the view high above the road course in Sebring, Florida on March 17th, St. Patrick's Day, 1990, as a field of 50 race cars representing GT prototypes, GT lights, GTOs, and GTUs prepared for the start. And this is how official IMSA announcer Bill Bowser introduced the top qualifiers.
The starting grid for the 12-hour endurance contest has Derek Daly, the Irishman, driving the number 84 Nissan ZX Turbo, which was qualified on the pole at a record-breaking 127 plus miles per hour by co-driver Chip Robinson. Alongside in the front row will be Frenchman Bob Wallach inside the number 86 Texaco Haviland Star Porsche 962. Starting in second row, third place, Bob Earl out of Larkspur, California, drives the second blue, white, and red Nissan number 83. Alongside in the second row, John Nielsen, the Dane, in the XJR12, the V12 Jaguar number 60. Starting fifth in the third row, number 67, the Nissan ZX Turbo, prepared by Jim Busby in California and driven by John Paul Jr. Starting sixth from the grid in the third row, Drake Olson of Connecticut in number 98, the Toyota Eagle, prepared by Dan Gurney.
Here's a look at the 4.1 mile Sebring road course. Down the front straight into turn one, a 90 degree left-hander. Then it's up through turn two, just a little jog to the right. Then up to turn three, known as the carousel, and you might see lots of passing going into this turn during the race. Then it's a big, long, gradual sweeper to the right, where the cars will be accelerating under the drive-over bridge and the footbridge into the camel hairpin, where cars will be dropping all the way down to first gear, into the chicane, right, and then left. Then on to warehouse straight, to turn eight, a 90-degree right-hander. Then a quick straight down to turn nine with little braking, and then past the air paddock and the water tower onto the long snaky straight that leads to turns 10, 11, and 12, and the fastest part of the course. Here, the GTP cars will be traveling well in excess of 180 miles an hour into turn 13, and then back onto the front straight and the start-finish line. The GTPs run laps here of just under 2 minutes. The weather, always a wild card before any 12-hour race at Sebring. Here in Florida, in very late winter, there are wild temperature swings and almost spontaneous rainfall. Some Sebring races begin under beautiful sunshine, only to end under torrential downpours. The forecast for the 1990 race, some clouds and maybe a shower late. And there were other questions to be asked. And as usual, those questions centered around the major players in the GTP category. Derek Daly was on the pole in the number 84 Nissan, but the Jaguars looked very strong in practice and qualifying. And Bob Wallach in his Porsche 962 had qualified right next to Derek Daly on the grid. And what about the Toyotas? Would they establish their presence at Sebring? Just a few of the riddles that were yet to be answered as the 38th running of the 12 Hours of Sebring drew closer.
Out from underneath the Goodyear Bridge, out of turn 13 here at Sebring. They take the green flag from Jim Sidley, the starter. The Nissan pulls to the front right away to the inside and to the outside. The 86 Texaco Haviland Star Porsche. Bob Wallach, the Frenchman at the wheel, goes to the outside. He'll go around the Nissan. He pulls 8-10 car lengths ahead of both the Nissan of Derek Daly and Bob Earl. Down now into turn three, and still the Texaco Haviland Star, that Porsche, a Bruce Levin machine out of Seattle, Washington, showing its muscle here early in the 38th running of the 12 Hours of Sebring. Once again, underneath the Camel Crossover Bridge, the drive-over bridge, they'll go down now into what's known as the hairpin, a right-hander and a hard right-hander. At the hairpin, Derek Daly brings the 84 car right up onto the back side of the Porsche, and right behind him comes Bob Earl in the second Nissan ZX Turbo. As they go down what's known as warehouse straight, it's the Porsche ahead by 5, 6, 7 car lengths. But again, when they go into the turns, the Nissan seem to catch up onto the back of the Porsche. So the Porsche having to brake just a little bit. Wallach takes a little bit of the trip that left rear tires off into the gravel, kicks up a little bit of sand and dust. Now on to the airport portion of the course. Brand newly paved for this year. A little bit of a chicane there, but they're able to straighten it out when they put the speed on. Down the back chute, they'll count the airport runway portion of this 4.11 mile long circuit. A real long, almost over 1 mile run each time around, in which the Porsche of Bob Wallach is able now to put a bit more of a move. They come on down the first lap completion with the Porsche in the lead, Nissan, then Jaguar, and then the Nissan from Busby. Bob Wallach again pulls out just a little bit. He comes down the front straight underneath the start-finish line. Second lap now into this 12-hour event. Very early, a long way to go. The Porsches with the colors of black, then of course the red Texaco emblazoned on top, goes down to turn three again with still a lead over the two Nissans. The Nissans can play catch up down in the slower portions of the course when the turbos do kick in. The Wallach driven Porsche does seem to have a little bit more muscle at the controls of Bob Wallach. The Alucraft automobile, the Porsche 962 driven by Hurley Haywood of Jacksonville Ford and co-driver Scott Chubot out of Fort Lauderdale, Florida. This car started 50th on the grid in last place, coming off of pit row. The reason? They blew a turbo early on and, of course, had to change that before they could get up into the starting field. Hurley Haywood of Jacksonville, Florida, the only driver to win the 24 Hours of Daytona and the 24 Hours of Le Mans in 1 year. But that was years ago. Scott Chubot, the Camel Lights champ from last year, comes up to the Camel Prototype Series as a shoe-in driver simply because the car, the Camel Light 4 at the hands of Linda Ludeman, his co-driver, caught fire in the practice earlier this week. She was not seriously injured. Within four laps of this long endurance event, the faster cars have now started lapping the back markers of this 50-car field. Running onto the back markers, that gives the Nissan of Derek Daly just a little bit more room to catch up to the back of the lead car, the Porsche 962 and Bob Wallach of Strasbourg, France. As they go and weave through that slower traffic, it gives the slower cars a bit of a chance to catch up to the rest of the field, but they move to the outside of the track to let pass on the inside those faster cars coming by. Porsche 962 puts its sights on one of the Mazdas, one of the GTO automobiles in this race today. Goes to the outside and followed right behind by the Nissan of Daly, the Irishman. Once again, into the turns, the Nissan right up onto the back spoiler of the Porsche, but he's going to give him some room. No way to pass now. They'll have to go three wide as they go into the turn. They've put a bigger separation now on the rest of the cars. Down to turn 11, a couple of Porsches have come together, one sitting on the track and smoking at the present time. It looks like the Chris Kraft automobile. The rest of the vehicles going out to the outside around him. A real close call there. He gets out, he goes over to the corner workers and will go over the wall. So Chris Kraft and the 26 Porsche in the GTU out of it for this race.
That incident in turn 11 brought out the yellow flag, and that brought several cars into the pits, including the pole sitter, Derek Daly, in the number 84 Nissan. It's a pit stop the Nissan crew would rather soon forget. A tire was down the left rear, and Chip Robinson was ready to take over for Derek Daly. With Bob Wallach setting the pace in the Havilland Star Porsche, this is not the complicated pit stop the Nissan team would have preferred this early. Plus, whenever you run a GTP car on a shredded tire for any distance, there can always be damage to the ultralight suspension components. The seconds ticked off. Robinson gets into the cockpit. New rubber is mounted. The Nissan crew checks the undercarriage for damage. Then there's a delay. Robinson wants to get underway, but the crew isn't through underneath the car. Finally, they're back out, but indecision. Should the car be taken down off the jacks? Finally, it is. But when it is, the car stalls. Robinson tries to restart it. The crew looks back underneath again. Finally, Robinson is underway, but the pit stop took over a minute. Now to Don Westcott with a history lesson on Sebring.
During World War II, the term international competition had a much more ominous meaning than it does today. Hendricks Field, on the site of today's race, was a training facility for American pilots learning to fly the mighty B-17. These legendary airplanes served America mightily during the war years, and many of the men who soon became decorated heroes learned their skills on the runways of Hendricks. In the early 50s, the world became sports car crazy, and Alec Allman brought a different kind of warfare to what was now called Sebring Airport. Sports car racing, thundering sports cars with powerful engines, primitive suspensions that shook the tarmac as horsepower replaced air power. Stirling Moss, Lance Revenlow, and Sir Jack Brabham. That's right, Jeff's dad, were just a few of the men who sought to conquer Sebring's challenging layout. Now, 40 years later, the cars and the men are different. The course has gone through some changes too, but it's still Sebring, and its name still echoes with a power and bravado that was born here years ago.
The view of Sebring from the air. Meanwhile, down on the track, the first caution period of the 1990 running of the 12 Hours of Sebring was about to end.
Coming back off the first caution flag of the day, with the Mitsubishi safety car getting ready to bring them to the green flag once again, the 67 Nissan, Jim Busby prepared CX Turbo, John Paul Jr., West Palm, Florida, the driver, managed a quicker pit stop than the rest, so he'll come out in the lead at least for the time being. He's followed by the 86 Texaco Havoline Star Porsche of Cyril Vandermeer out of Indianapolis, Indiana. Then the Toyota's back in the field. Relatively missing, of course, the Nissan's green flag from Jim Sidley. The Nissan takes to the inside, but to the outside, Vandermeer brings the Porsche 962-86 out into the lead. The rest of the field pretty well strung out, but Nissan's well back in the pack. And if having come in for the pit stop during the caution flag come out late, they'll be playing catch-up to the rest of the front runners as they come back from that caution flag. The field consisting of GTO, GTU, IMSA cars and drivers, as well as the Camel prototypes and Camel light cars. Down to the field now comes the Nissan trying to play catch-up to the rest. Here's an incident now. The 23 car driven by Harrington up against the wall to the outside of the racetrack. The corner workers are at the scene looking at the driver. Things look pretty good. Driver moving inside. And the safety car, this is the 928 Porsche of IMSA, which is brought out into the field, even under green flag conditions that they have now, comes to the scene if aid is needed. Corner workers still attending to Harrington, the driver, the 23 Porsche 962. Bill Adam, the driver, along with Seabrook, a co-driver in that automobile. Driver's out and okay, and the signal is given. Back to the racing action now, and to the inside goes the 17 car. Hans Stuck takes Cyril Vandermeer as one Porsche bests another as they come out of turn number 13 and will try to start another lap.
After 2 hours of racing, here is what the leaderboard looked like. In first place, the number 67 Nissan of John Paul Jr. Then in second, number 86, the Porsche of Bob Wallach. In third, the number 99 Toyota of Rocky Moran. Price Cobb in fourth, and the number 60 Jaguar. Fifth, the number 33 Spice Chevy of Bernard Jourdain. Back with more of Sebring in just a moment.
2.5 hours into the event now, just a little over that. Dominic Dobson in number 86. Smoke comes from behind the car. That means trouble for the number 86 car. Running second to the number 17 Porsche of Hans Stuck. It'll mean a pit stop for the 86 this time, and they'll have to look to see if the trouble is terminal or not. But smoke coming from the car certainly is not a good sign.
This was indeed the end of the race for the number 86 Porsche 962 of Bob Wallach, Dominic Dobson, and Cyril Vandermeer. With only 2.5 hours of the 12 hours run, a head gasket had blown, retiring the car, which had qualified second. As a dejected Dominic Dobson got out of the car, it was a major disappointment for not only the team, but Porsche fans as well, who felt this car could make a serious run at ending the GTP dominance of the Nissans and Jaguars at Sebring this time out. As team manager Walter Gerber inspected the motor and assessed the damage, it was obvious to the Texaco Havoline team today was not their day. But the day wasn't over for Bob Wallach. After the 86 car retired, he jumped behind the wheel of the number zero Porsche 962 of Yost Racing, a team he had done a lot of work for.
The zero Porsche 962, the Yost Racing car, European configuration automobile that has had success in the past, puts the chase now on the Toyota. Bob Wallach out of Strasbourg, France now, changing rides early on in the event. Past the Toyota, out of camera view now, goes down into about turn number 8 at the present time, and the Toyota really being put back a number of car lengths by the acceleration and Wallach in the Porsche. Wallach certainly a grand Porsche driver, there is no doubt about it. He has done most of his stints through his driving career. This one-time Olympic skier, now a race car driver, does well in the Porsche automobiles. The Frenchman once again in the zero Porsche 962 passes quickly around one of the slower markets markers and goes to the backside of the course at the present time. When he comes out in turn number 12, he takes a wide berth, goes out almost to the cones and brings it back. Wallach getting into the zero automobile after Dominic Dobson aboard the 86 Porsche 962 blew a head gasket, and that gave Wallach the chance to go to another ride for the remainder of this 12-hour event.
And now Don Westcott takes a look at some of the things that happen at racetracks besides racing.
If you've been to an IMSA event, you know that there's more to a Grand Prix weekend than just racing. While the racing fans and the family are watching the time trials or the featured race, there's plenty to do on the Midway, with its arcades and games, souvenirs, and culinary treats. This Camel GT driving simulator gives everyone a chance to experience the thrills of Grand Prix racing the way the driver experiences it, from behind the wheel. Using a computer-controlled electro-hydraulic system, the Camel GT driving simulator recreates the sense of intense acceleration and deceleration experienced by the driver when passing, cornering, and braking in the heat of Grand Prix racing. With a stroke of a golf club, Mazda gives everyone a chance to win a souvenir poster. Whether you travel in an ultra-luxury mobile home or call a tent your home for the weekend, camping in the infield is always a unique experience. There's something for everyone at an IMSA Grand Prix race. The next time you and the family are looking for a great weekend or fun-filled afternoon, come to the races. It's great family fun. See you there.
The two Nissans, 83-84, going into the carousel now. That'll be Jeff Brabham, the 83. The 84 would be Derek Daly. The pass was made. Daly got around him. Brabham, the 1989 Camel GT IMSA champion. And, of course, Derek Daly, one of the co-drivers in the team, made the pass on the chief driver of the squad. And Daly pulls pretty much away as they get into traffic. Daly in the 83 car, now with the lead as he went around Jeff Brabham, but Brabham keeping only about a 4, 5, maybe 6 car length distance between he and the Nissan leader at the present time, going through that slower traffic where passes probably won't be made. Three slower cars up into the front now, awaiting the approach of those Nissans after the pass had been made. Meantime, the number 33 Chevy Spice automobile of Tom Kendall out of La Cañada, California, the 1988 GTU champion, teamed with Bernard Jourdain, moving up on the 67 car. It's 15 laps back from the lead 83 Nissan at the present time, but the 33 Chevy Spice of Kendall now putting the move on the 67 car, trying to set the sights on the third place machine, the 61 Castrol Jaguar. Meantime, the Zero automobile, the Porsche 962, in second place behind the Nissan, making a move on some slower traffic.
So after roughly a third of the race, this is what the leaderboard looked like. In first place, the number 83 Nissan, now driven by Derek Daly. In second, the Zero Porsche, driven by Henri Pascarolo and Bob Wallach. In third, the Spice Chevy, number 33, of Tom Kendall. In fourth, Andy Wallace driving the number 61 Jaguar. And in fifth, the number 98 Toyota, driven by Drake Olson. During the week, Mel Kisner had a chance to ask some of the drivers what it's like to compete in this classic event at Sebring.
When you go into a race as long as this, you try and plan a strategy, but so much changes after the first couple of hours because you don't know how strong the opposition is going to be. We're going to start off the first 2 or 3 hours and run a comfortable pace. And if somebody's faster than us, let them go. If we're pulling away from people, we'll continue to do that. As long as we're in a rhythm, and the drivers are not taking too much out of the cars, then after 6 hours, we can plan the rest of the race, whether we need to go faster, push harder, or conserve.
It is still rough in places, and you have to run a higher ride height to make sure that your body work is not going to destruct over the course of 12 hours. Things that we can get away with in a three-hour race won't make it here. So the cars are especially high, and they're detuned a little bit so that we give the engine as fair a shake as possible.
Hans, this is a particularly exciting race for you. Could you tell me why, please?
Yeah, first of all, because Sebring is my absolute favorite racetrack in the world. It is a racetrack which has not been destroyed by silly chicanes like FIA did in tracks in Europe. And it's a track that requires a big heart to drive. It really requires a lot of driving skill. And I won here 3 times already, and maybe it's a fourth time now.
Do you plan to employ any particular strategy to ensure that fourth win?
There's nothing you can assure in racing, I tell you that, but if you win it 3 times, you know how to do it. You gotta begin quite steady, easy with the car, and after 6-7 hours, when a couple of cars have dropped out of the race, and your car is still in good shape, then put the metal to the, put the pedal to the metal, and then we see if we can win it.
Bob, tell me, how do you feel about your qualifying position?
Oh, I feel wonderful about the qualifying position because I didn't have to do it. Chip did it, and I'm starting on the front row. It's great.
Well, yeah, it's a very tough course, very interesting. The first time you leave the pit lane, it's quite a miracle that you actually come back round across the start-finish line.
Bobber, a lot of California Ford Believe Nissan, number 83 ZX Turbo car, down the runway backstretch, and he tags a couple of cones, pushes them off to the left side, going down into turn number 13. The final turn of the course goes to the outside of one of the slower cars, then goes inside of a Camel Lights car, the number 32 Buick Spice, driven by Tomas Lopez and Fermin Velez. Lopez at the wheel, they tag just a little bit, and the 83 car under Earl slows before they come underneath the Goodyear Bridge. Matter of fact, he goes way wide after the contact, kicks up some dust before going under the bridge, and then down past the start-finish stripe to end another lap and to begin yet another in this 12-hour endurance event. Looks like there's not too much damage to the side of the car after having in contact up into turns number one and two. Now he comes up yet on some more of the slower traffic. The two Toyota automobiles, Dan Gurney prepared All-American Racers 98 and 99, having lengthy pit stops, one of them for brakes and seat belts, and the other having a 7 to 10 minute pit stop, very lengthy even in a 12-hour event.
Right now, let's take a look at a slow-motion replay of the close call that Bob Earl, now driving the number 83 Nissan, got himself into just a moment ago. One of the major concerns that drivers in a race such as this always talk about is the speed differential between the GTPs and three other classes of cars competing. Earl in the faster GTP Nissan is trying to pass a slower GTU car on one side and a slower lights car on the other. He's not in the place on the track he would like to be in for this particular corner. He's trying to gently coax the car to ease it back into the proper line, but it's too late, and he gets onto the apron, luckily without doing any damage. Now let's take a look at some of the cars that were still in contention at this point in the race. The number zero Porsche 962, driven by Bob Wallach. Despite some earlier problems, the number 83 Nissan, driven by Bob Earl, is still well into the hunt. Another Porsche 962, driven by John Hotchkiss, his son John Hotchkiss Jr. and James Adams, which qualified 13th, still within range of the leader. Two more cars contending. The number 61 Jaguar, driven by Davy Jones, and right behind, the 67 Nissan, driven by John Paul Jr. and Kevin Cogan. And the Spice Chevrolet, driven by Tommy Kendall, is still well within reach in fifth place. Now to Don Westcott.
IMSA pays a lot of attention to safety in racing. Unlike the early days of racing, today when a driver rolls a car into a little ball of scrap metal and there's fire present due to the inevitable spilled fuel, the driver will generally walk away, a dramatic improvement in just the past decade. An area that has received a lot of scrutiny is the prevention of fire, or at least the quick reduction of the flames and the heat. The driver and the crew are protected by the clothes that they wear, made of a material called Nomex. Bill Simpson of Simpson Safety Equipment demonstrates the effectiveness of the material by setting himself on fire. With the aid of Nomex, a driver has a chance to get out of a burning racer unhurt. In the pit area, there is one crewman assigned the job of fireman. Watch the crewman, who is back to us. If he should do any work on the car, the team will be penalized. His job? Spot a fire, put it out. It looked big, the flames fed by high-octane racing fuel, but the extinguisher knocked it down quickly, allowing the car back into action. In fact, this car went on to win this event.
Back to the 12 hours of Sebring on the IMSA Grand Prix Hour. The number 67 Nissan, moving into the pits, now driven by Kevin Cogan, was plagued with trouble throughout much of the first part of the race. Team owner Jim Busby, a former driver himself, felt the car could be leading the race had the collection of difficulties not arisen. On this stop, Cogan explained that the car was stuck in third gear. The car had qualified fifth and is essentially identical to the Nissans driven by Brabham, Earl, Daly, and Robinson. But John Paul Jr., Cogan's co-driver, reflected optimism they could get back into the race once repairs were made.
Easy fix, you know what it is. Be back out in a minute.
As it turned out, the fix was not so easy. After what seemed like an eternity, the car was finally pushed out of the pits, and it was obvious that it could not accelerate as quickly as it had before. Kevin Cogan was still locked in third gear. And that meant that it would be almost impossible to make a run on the leaders. The best that they could hope for today would be just to finish the 12 hours of Sebring and try to place as high as they could.
Down to back shoot, it's the 61 Jaguar, the V12, the green and white Castrol car, the pass to the inside on Andy Wallace by Drake Olson, the 98 Toyota. Now the Toyota is sixth place, five laps down to the third place Wallace Jaguar. The leader, 83 Bob Earl, the Californian, and the 83 Nissan comes up onto the Jaguar as they finish turn number 13, the last turn under the Goodyear Bridge again. 98 Toyota seemingly in the first spot, but remember, laps separate these automobiles. The Nissan tries to make a move. He does onto the Jaguar, putting the Jaguar 61 12-cylinder car another lap down as the Nissan motors on.
After 7 hours into the 12 hours of Sebring, Bob Wallach was leading in the number zero Porsche when he spun it, coming out of turn 13. The car stalled and was in a very dangerous place to be on the road course. With the late afternoon sun shining into the faces of the drivers heading into turn 13, the number zero Porsche was in extreme jeopardy. Course workers risking their own lives to help Wallach get out of harm's way. The number 83 Nissan, now driven by Derek Daly, was running in second and would almost certainly take over the lead next time around. IMSA rules state that cars which break down on the course cannot be worked on if the car is in any danger of being struck by other race cars. Also, only the driver can make repairs on the car while it is anywhere on the course, outside of the team's pit area. The number zero Porsche was pitting at the entry end of pit lane, which meant less of a push to get it back to the pit crew. So far, it had been a very eventful day for Bob Wallach. The popular Frenchman had begun the race second on the grid in the number 86 Texaco Haviland Porsche 962 until it blew a head gasket 2.5 hours into the race. Meanwhile, Derek Daly in the number 83 Nissan headed into the pits for a routine stop after putting Wallach into second and one lap down. Wallach was still in the pits at this point, having the battery in his 962 Porsche replaced. If Wallach were to get out of the pits first, he would unlap himself, although he would still be over 4 miles away from first place. So far, there had been 15 lead changes in the race. The record, 19 lead changes set in 1983, was for an entire race. At this point, the record stood a real possibility of being broken. Wallach manages to beat Daly out of the pits. Wallach is still in second, but there were close to 5 hours left to go in the race at this point, and former Olympic skiing champion Bob Wallach would soon be making another impressive charge toward the front in his Porsche 962. Right now, Don Westcott takes a look at another Porsche that spends a lot of time on the racetrack, but not for the obvious reason. This Porsche helps to save lives.
It's known as the Emergency Rapid Response Program. A joint effort between IMSA, Porsche, and Methodist Hospital, it can place needed medical care and equipment at the scene of a race mishap in a matter of seconds.
Seconds can make the difference. And what we really needed was the ability to put a trauma specialist on the scene as quickly as possible. The car is driven by a licensed IMSA driver who is also an extraction specialist. His primary function is to deliver his passenger, who is one of the leading trauma specialists in the country, to the scene as quickly as possible. The idea is, while the racing is still happening, we can dispatch this car directly into race traffic.
As medical director for IMSA, my job is to coordinate the facilities and make sure we have appropriate equipment at the track and appropriate referral hospitals and so on. Most of what we do is designed to stack the odds in favor of the driver.
A team effort with one goal in mind, saving lives.
The green flag after the caution, and the Nissan takes the lead down the front straightaway. It heads up into turn number one, trying to put distance. Derek Daly at the wheel between he and the rest of the field. Following a caution flag with 4.11 miles ahead of you with no traffic is a good time to set everybody into the back and put them into traffic so that they're slower trying to catch up. Into turn number three now comes the Nissan. It's a left-hander, not a real hard left-hander, and he puts the distance on the Chevrolet 33, the 17 Porsche also. Coming down the line now is the wind friction proofing number 10 Porsche 962 back in the pack, then some GTO GTU cars.
Derek Daly, one of the true stars of endurance racing, originally from Ireland, who now makes his home in Noblesville, Indiana, was leading the race at this point in the number 83 Nissan. The car that won the pole with Chip Robinson at the wheel had a record speed of 127.808 miles per hour. Right now, let's see how the Jaguar team takes the high-tech approach to keeping their drivers fresh in a 12-hour Enduro.
As the driver comes down pit road, immediately the driver gets out of the car. The first thing I do is I have a cold towel waiting for him to put around his neck to reduce the body temperature. I didn't take a pulse meter straight away, and it's quite easy to take his pulse. By putting it on his ear, it gives me an instant pulse. I get him back here into my mobile home, where I take off all his clothes, including his helmet. I put his uniform in to be dried. I take his helmet away, and I have it dried so that there's no body fluid whatsoever left in the clothes. I then check him over to see if he's got any bruising. If he has, I use ultrasound on him. I also use an electric massager, which is very, very good to stimulate the blood flow into the muscles. After I've done everything and checked him over and seen that everything is okay, I then allow him to lie down and rest. I do not allow him to sleep. Before he goes back into the car again, I put him in an exercise bike out there, and I bring up his racing pulse so that when he gets back into the car, he's getting back fresh, exactly the same as if he's starting the race.
Racing Porsche out of turn number 12 now. The Porsche 962 seeming to slow. Left headlights are on the car. A slower Camel Lights automobile. One of the Essex Buicks coming up to the outside of the car, and the Camel Light car will pass the GT prototype smoke out of the right rear. Looks like tire smoke from the right rear of the Bob Wallach driven Porsche 962. So the Yost car should be making its way to the pits. Zero automobile. A Porsche experiencing right rear tire problems in the race, running in second spot to the Nissan number 83. Into the pits comes the zero car for service.
So Bob Wallach, while gaining ground on the lead Nissan, now driven by Bob Earl, suffers yet another setback. He pits for a new tire and a new driver as Henri Pescarolo will climb aboard. Had this been a sprint race, the number zero Yost Porsche would surely be out of contention. But some fast work by the pit crew gets the new tire mounted quickly. The drivers make a quick swap, and the car is underway again without losing a position. He's still in second place. The number zero Porsche qualified 8th fastest for the race and is slightly different in setup from the other 962s in the race. This Porsche is of European specification, designed to compete in the World Endurance Championship in comparison to Porsches designed to run strictly in IMSA competition. And so after 8 hours and 200 laps, this is the way the leaderboard looked in the 12 hours of Sebring. In first place, the number 83 Nissan, now driven by Bob Earl. In second, that zero Porsche 962, driven by Henri Pescarolo. In third, the number 61 Jaguar, driven by Davy Jones. Jeff Brabham, Bob Earl's teammate, in fourth place, in the other Nissan, car number 84. And in fifth, Bernard Jourdan in the Spice Chevrolet, car number 33. Two-thirds of the race was over, but maybe the toughest period of the race was yet to come. As darkness fell over the course at Sebring, and over the years, it has been a time frame filled with fact and folklore. Some of the strange and dramatic events that have unfolded in the dark hours of this race are still the grist for many a great racing story. And as the drivers turned on their lights in the 38th running of this historic event, little did they know of the special twist that awaited them in the miles ahead. We'll be back to show them to you in just a moment on the IMSA Grand Prix Hour. Welcome back to the IMSA Grand Prix Hour and the 12 hours of Sebring. With 2 hours left to go in the race, the number 61 Jaguar, the third place car, came in for a scheduled pit stop and a driver change. Andy Wallace replacing Davy Jones. And there's been another lead change, the 18th of the race, one short of the all-time record. The number zero Yost Porsche 962, driven by Bob Wallach, is now leading again. And the number 83 Nissan, now driven by Derek Daly, is in second place. The Jaguars finished 1-2 at Daytona, but were shut out at Miami. They were hoping for a victory here at Sebring, but their chances look slim at this point. Now Don Westcott with a great moment in Sebring history.
It was 1967. Ford came to Sebring with a new lemon yellow Mark IV, built and tested just for Sebring. Behind the wheel would be Bruce McLaren and Mario Andretti. Today, they would do wheeled battle with the winged Chaparrals, Corvettes, Ferraris, and Porsches. With the classic Le Mans start, the field was away, except for the Ford Mark IV that McLaren stalled and the Chaparral that would not start and require the mechanic's help. The early lead was contested by a new Alfa T33 and Charlie Kolb's Ferrari Dino. As the afternoon wore on, Spence and the Chaparral began his march to the lead. Meanwhile, the Ford Mark IV led the way. But at McLaren's first pit stop, the Chaparral took the lead. Mario relieved McLaren and led out after the fleet-winged Chaparral. Andretti's Ford would regain the lead, and until dusk, the Chaparral and Mark IV, shadowed by Piper's green Ferrari, dueled through the 5-plus-mile course. But the pace took its toll, and at 6 o'clock, the Chaparral retired with transmission problems. As night fell, it was Porsche on the march in chase of the sprinting Fords. With just 30 minutes left, the Mark II Ford retired, leaving the Mark IV alone to battle three closing Porsches. But in the end, the Mark IV held off Stuttgart's challenge by a scant 8 seconds. A young Mario Andretti, the American from Italy, and Bruce McLaren from New Zealand would ride their Ford to victory lane. And that's the way it was at Sebring in 1967. Another great moment in Grand Prix racing history.
The leading zero car, the Porsche 962 Yost racing car, comes into the pits. Looks like a real short stop. It'll be a driver change. Henri Pascarolo, the Frenchman, goes to the wheel of the zero car. Now, it is the leader at the present time. Lights ablaze. Pulls out of the far end of pit road. That really takes him into turn number one. He'll merge with traffic, as a matter of fact, right alongside one of the Nissan ZX Turbos. Meantime, a light rainfall. Rain had been forecast most of the day, but did not come about until in the evening hours, under the lights and in the dark. The light rainfall brought many of the cars in so that they could go to the rain tires. They can race in the rain as long as they put treaded tires in and go away from the slicks, which would not give them traction should they leave them on. Up through turn eight now, and the lights on the pace car are off for this caution period. We should go to green shortly now after they've completed this tour of the circuit. The car's in behind the pace car, getting ready to go down that long, long back straightaway, the airport runway. Lights ablaze here in the nighttime. Nighttime until the checkered flag in the finish, just a short time away. Down the back straight now and heading into turn number 13. Getting ready to go. Coming underneath the ridge one more time. Here comes the green flag from the starter stand. Once again, they're going down into turn one, two by two. Up across the start-finish stripe and down into turn number one. Turns one and two. About this time, they'll be heading toward that 180-degree left-hand carousel turn, number five. It'll be the Jaguar of Andy Wallace now and the Porsche of Hans Stuck trying to make a go around the Yost Porsche of Henri Pascarolo. They're going to make the pass, and the Jaguar will pick up another lap on the leader at this time. He'll be on the same lap as the leading Porsche for now.
10 hours of racing behind them, and the outcome of the race was anything but certain. Some cars, which had remained in contention for much of the race, were still in the top 10, but getting no closer to the leaders, such as the number 10 Porsche 962 of John Hotchkiss Sr. and Jr. from Pasadena, California. They were running a respectable fourth after qualifying 13th. Daly repasses Pescarolo for the lead, and then real trouble coming out of turn 13. Pescarolo in the number zero Porsche 962 tangles with a GTU car, the number 57 Nissan 300ZX of Alistair Oeg. Both cars heavily damaged and sitting at the top of the front straight. Pescarolo is out of the Porsche, but Oeg is still sitting in his number 57 Nissan. The yellow flag is out at Sebring, and the day is over, finally, for the Yost Racing Porsche.
You can just make out the zero automobile, the Porsche, Henri Pascarolo, sitting sideways on the track. There is another race car sitting behind underneath the bridge right now, being attended to by the corner workers as the dust begins to clear from this latest incident.
While the emergency medical crew was working to free Oeg from his heavily damaged car, it was apparent that this incident could have been much worse. Let's take a look at a replay of what happened exiting turn 13. At the top of the front stretch, Pescarolo in the Porsche and Oeg in the Nissan touch. The Porsche spins across the track and collides a second time with Oeg's Nissan. The Nissan and the Porsche both stop in the middle of the track. Traffic squeezes by the wreckage without any further contact. And if you look closely, you can see a tire from Pescarolo's Porsche rolling down the track. Eventually, it comes to a stop 500 feet away below the starter's stand. The number 10 Porsche 962 of John Hotchkiss struck the tire before safety crews had a chance to remove it from the track. Alistair Oeg from Jamestown, New York, the driver of the Nissan in the incident, was starting his third IMSA GTU race. He's also a veteran Firestone Firehawk driver, and he competes in the Luke Clutch Challenge. Ironically, at the time of the accident, both cars were running second in their respective classes. Pescarolo was second overall and in the GTP category. Oeg was second in GTU. Oog was knocked unconscious in the accident, but became conscious and alert by the time he was removed from the car using the jaws of life and taken to nearby Highlands Regional Medical Center. His injuries were not serious. Pescarolo was also taken to Highlands for x-rays of a possible minor neck injury. The finish of the 12 Hours of Sebring 1990 coming up on the IMSA Grand Prix Hour.
It's the two Nissans. They'll come around the turn now, 13, get ready to take the green flag flies, and it's Nissan coming down to the starter stand, getting ready to go back into turn 1, 2, and 3. The two Nissans trying to battle. It is Chip Robinson trying to get around Derek Daly to put him another lap down to try to catch up before the end of this contest. They'll go to the carousel one more time, the hard left-hand turn as they head for the hairpin, and it will be Chip Robinson. He'll go around Daly, and it'll take another lap now. Although Daly's in the lead, the other Nissan is closing. Here at Sebring International Raceway, nighttime racing, Sebring 12 hours getting ready to close. It's the two Nissans, the blue, white, and red champions of 88 and 89. In the car that leads, Derek Daly, second place but two laps down, Chip Robinson, Oldwick, New Jersey. Way back in the pack, however, running third is the Jaguar XJR 12 being driven by Jan Lammers.
In the final 45 minutes of this 12-hour race, it was a hodgepodge of driver changes, passing for position, and last-minute strategy. With two cars and four drivers, the Nissan team was an exercise in trying to pay attention. As the number 83 car of Daly leads the race, the 84 Nissan with Chip Robinson aboard, who drove the 83 car in qualifying, is now second, while Jan Lammers, who took over for Andy Wallace in the number 61 Jaguar, is in third, but is coming on hard in the final hour of the race. The 84 Nissan of Robinson is physically ahead of Daly in the 83 car, but is in second place, and realistically has to come all the way around the circuit to catch up to Daly if he wants to take a shot at the lead. But soon, Jan Lammers in the V12 Jaguar is knocking on Robinson's door for second place. Lammers is glued to Robinson's tailpipes as they streak down the front straight toward turn number one. With each passing moment, a Nissan Jaguar showdown for the checkered flag is looking more imminent. Derek Daly is in the pits. It's a quickie, and the 83 car still leads Robinson by a substantial distance after the pit stop. Now, it's four laps later, and Chip Robinson in the second place number 84 Nissan comes into the pits. A driver change. Robinson out, Jeff Brabham getting in. At that moment in time, many people questioned the wisdom of a driver change, which just cost Nissan second place. Would that move cost them later on? With only 30 minutes left in the 12 hours of Sebring, the leaderboard looked like this. In first place, the number 83 Nissan driven by Derek Daly. In second place, the V12 Jaguar, car number 61 of Jan Lammers. In third place, the other red, white, and blue Nissan prototype, car number 84, driven by Jeff Brabham. In fourth, Porsche 962 number 10, driven by John Hotchkiss. And in fifth place, John Paul Jr. in the number 67 Nissan, the Jim Busby car. Now, only one lap remaining in the 12 hours of Sebring, and Jeff Brabham has caught and passed the 61 Jaguar of Lammers for second. The gamble that the Nissan team had taken by pitting 30 minutes ago and changing drivers has paid off. It appears to be a 1-2 finish for Nissan at Sebring.
Derek Daly takes the checkered flag, ending the 12 hours of Sebring 1990.
And the Nissan pit erupts. It's the second 1-2 finish of the season. Bill Bowser talks to winning driver Derek Daly.
I started in one car, finished in another. I mean, I think it's just a credit to Nissan Performance Technology that they can change their strategy so quickly midstream and still come away with success that we had today.
Of course, with a double stint, that just put a lot more pressure on you, too.
Well, it does in a way, but you got to remember this.
The little Irishman.
Yeah, my mother-in-law, Ruth Ann, brought me this and gave it to me this morning. Obviously brought me luck.
So after their convincing victories at Sebring and earlier at Miami, it appeared that Nissan was not about to allow Jaguar's stunning win at Daytona in the season opener to interfere with their quest for another IMSA championship. In future editions of the IMSA Grand Prix Hour, we'll be taking you back to some of the other great battles that were fiercely fought in IMSA's premier racing series. Until then, this is Bill Stevens on behalf of Bill Bowser, Don Westcott, and the entire crew at the Global Television Network, thanking you for joining us and reminding you to please buckle up and drive safely.